You're listening to the audio production of Sister Eve, Private Eye by Lynne Hinton, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Hilary Huber.
Dedicated to the memory of O. Jackson Hinton. It's ironic that you died the same year this book is published. However, I am certainly old enough to know that often we never solve the great mysteries of life. Sometimes we can only accept them. I miss you, Dad. Prologue. Chaz Cheston grabbed his keys and quietly made his way out the back door. He had exactly 1 hour and 15 minutes to pick up the final pages of the script and drive to the airport in Santa Fe. A jet was arriving that morning to pick him up and make a quick turnaround trip back to California. He stood beside his prized sports car, patted the bulging pocket of his black leather jacket, and glanced at his watch. He was late. Ron Polland had arranged back-to-back meetings in Los Angeles that morning. Cheston was scheduled to check in with the assistant director at 10 o'clock, the casting director at 10:30, and the director of photography at 11. Polland, the producer, was expecting the director at the studio production offices at noon. There was a lunch planned for the investors later, and the entire afternoon was to be devoted to the final budget approval. Cheston just hoped that Polland wouldn't ask for a statement from the production account at the bank before the meetings. He jumped in the car, turned on the engine, and sped down the driveway. Cheston planned to take the meetings, hand over the finished pages, and get his check so he could make the deposit before the withdrawal had been noticed. The assistant manager at the bank, the tall blonde taking evening acting classes, had already given him a heads up that Polland had asked for weekly statements for the account. Chaz thought about the woman, recalling how he had arranged a personal studio tour, and suggested that she would be great in his next project, a lie he would deal with later. He knew that Polland was already suspicious about what had happened to the advance. Just out of rehab, Chaz wouldn't even be hired by the studio without insurance. He couldn't shake that monkey off his back, no matter how hard he tried. Polland had not been happy when his star writer and director had flown to New Mexico more than a month ago, claiming he needed to be on location to finish the script for the film he'd promised would start production in 3 weeks. It was just before dawn, and the sun was still well below the barren peaks of the Ortiz Mountains, marking the horizon to the east. The temperature was cooler than he'd expected, and he turned up the heat. He headed down the winding dirt road that would curve and dip for a couple of miles before hitting Highway 14. He recalled that the main drag through Madrid and Cerrillos was known as the Turquoise Trail, a 40-mile stretch of desert highway between Albuquerque and Santa Fe. He switched his headlights to bright, taking the curves as fast as he could. He recalled the directions he had used a few times before, trying to remember the exact route number and cattle guards to count. It was at least a 30-minute drive to the cabin outside of Madrid, and then at least 45 more to the airport. But all he had to do was drive by, pick up the necessary pages, drop off some cash, and he'd soon be on his way to Santa Fe. He'd figure out the other details of explaining his whereabouts later. Chaz cursed. If Ross had just emailed the pages to him, it would have saved him a needless, time-consuming trip. But he'd refused. He was sticking to his usual writing tool of an IBM Selectric typewriter. And if Chaz wanted this story by Ross Biltmore, he was going to get it the way Ross Biltmore wrote them all. Single-spaced narrative style, half-inch margins, Times Roman font, size 12. Somebody else was going to have to indent the pages of dialogue, add the characters' names to the lines, and supply the scene directions. He didn't care if there was a close-up on the hero or if the location was an interior or exterior. Ross Biltmore just wrote the story. Chaz Cheston headed east toward the rising sun, the sports car throwing up pebbles and raising dust and swirls behind him. Chaz and Ross had known each other since college, rooming together the last couple of years of school, although that didn't really mean anything since Chaz was never there. By the time Ross left the university and traveled across India to study with some religious guru, Chaz, son of a famous movie director and grandson of a well-respected producer, was already working as an assistant to an assistant director in a major Hollywood production. In the beginning, Ross simply wrote term papers and essays for Chaz, but then he began taking his roommate's exams when he could. However, in 20 years, that arrangement had evolved. Ross withdrew from his classes the second semester of his junior year, but remained a resident in the luxury apartment near campus, paid for by the Cheston family. He turned out to be a gifted writer. No one at the university ever found out about the forged papers, and no one in the industry knew where Chaz Cheston came up with his brilliant ideas for movies. Only Chaz and Ross knew the man who was really the genius behind the romantic comedies and the action-packed dramas. And for 20 years, that's the way it had been for the two friends. As far as Chaz knew, Ross never minded the anonymity, the lack of recognition, and he never asked for more money than what was offered. It was a solid business arrangement, and Chaz couldn't be happier, especially now. He made the turn on 14 and headed north. The sun was just starting to peek over the top of the Sangre de Cristos. He made the second left onto the dirt road and hit the accelerator. From this point, it was a straight shot to the house near Cedar Hill. He was still hoping to make good time. When he arrived at the entry to Ross's property, the fourth cattle guard and the second driveway off the road, he put the car in park and got out. He walked up to the gate, reached around, and slid the gate lock open, as he had been taught by Ross, and grabbed the small key he had been given from the pocket of his jacket. He opened the lock on the chain that was wrapped around the fence and the gate, yanked it through, pushed the gate, jumped back in his car, and pulled in, leaving the gate open. He hurried toward the small cabin built on the north side of a mesa. Stopping at the end of the drive, Chaz turned off the engine and waited. He looked around the house to see if any lights were on, and then got out of the car, heading to the back door. "Why on earth would anyone want to live way out here?" he asked himself and shook his head as he searched around him, making sure no one else was there. Feeling confident that he was alone, he walked to the porch and searched for the folder he'd been promised. Ross had explained when Chaz called over the weekend that he was heading out of town, but that he had finished the script, and the final scenes would be left under a blanket on a rocking chair on the east side of the house. He asked that Chaz put the cash and the gate key in the sentry safe at the other end of the property. Chaz had been given the combination, and after picking up the script, he planned to drive down to the barn and drop off the bundle of cash he had zipped in his jacket pocket. Ross, he had been instructed a long time ago, never wanted a check or direct deposit. He wanted cash only. No paper trail was just fine with the Hollywood filmmaker. Chaz eyed the outdoor furniture lining the long porch. There were two rocking chairs near the front door and another near a bench. Sure enough, the thick folder was under the old red Navajo blanket. Relieved, he stuck the folder under his arm and was heading to his car when he saw the lights coming up the driveway. It was still not quite sunrise, and the small round beams of light bounced up and down as they moved closer and closer to him. Chaz stood, frozen, watching as the vehicle pulled up beside his. The driver's door opened. At first, he thought it must be Ross home early, or maybe a neighbor, someone who watched the property when the owner was gone. He was squinting, trying to see who was getting out of the car, when he heard his name called and recognized the voice before he ever saw the face.
Christ have mercy.
He felt a sharp pain in the left part of his chest, and the folder under his arm fell. He dropped to his knees, the papers flying all around him, looking down at where he had been shot. He reached for his chest, expecting to find blood, but soon realized that what was lodged firmly under his skin was not a bullet, but a short, thin dart. He looked up.
I always heard the desert was a spiritual place, Charles.
The familiar face loomed over him. He felt tightness in his chest and pain radiating across his shoulders and down his left arm. The Hollywood director struggled for breath.
I just never figured you for the religious type, were the last words Chaz Cheston ever heard.
Chapter 1. Psst. The sound was a faint whisper and came from the chapel entrance. Sister Evangeline heard the noise, but did not rise from her kneeling position. Instead, she simply redoubled her prayers for patience. Breakfast had been served, and it was an hour past Lauds. After a quick ride to the town of Glorietta to clear her head, she had returned to the sanctuary for an extended period of scripture reading and meditation meant to aid her spiritual journey. She heard the whisper, but remained at the kneeling bench, the narrow beam hard beneath her knees. Candles burned on the altar, and the statue of Mary stood above the nun as she prayed. Saints watched from the stained glass windows as she closed her eyes and took in a breath. Maybe the whisper was not meant for her, she decided. She readjusted herself, folded her hands once again, and bowed lower. The pew she was on was empty except for her helmet, which had been placed beside her. Even though she hadn't actually worn it during the ride, she took it with her just to keep the questions and criticisms at bay. She couldn't help herself. She snuck a peek at it just to make sure it was still there. Satisfied that it had not been taken, she drew in a deep breath and began a recitation from the Psalms. She wanted to be obedient. She tried to be dutiful. And if being able to accomplish such a feat required extra prayers, Sister Evangeline was willing to do it. Lately, the well-seasoned nun had confessed to experiencing difficulty remaining patient with other members of her order at Our Lady of Guadalupe Abbey. And with some of the changes being made at the direction of the Santa Fe Diocese, especially the new order that was requiring the nuns to move out. She and Brother Oliver, the vice superior of the monastery that historically housed both monks and nuns, had agreed that additional time of solitude and prayers might aid her with her personal weaknesses, especially her anger. He had meant clocking hours in the chapel, but Evangeline knew that a ride on her Harley calmed and centered her more than sitting in a quiet room. So she decided to do them both. She finished the recitation and began her prayer. Psst. There it was again. She remained bowed. She kept her eyes closed. Maybe someone else was in the chapel. Maybe someone was sitting behind her and was being called, she thought. Maybe they would take the cue of her silence and leave quietly. Or maybe whoever was trying to capture her attention would realize Evangeline was in prayer and leave her alone. Psst. 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 She rose up and jerked her head around.
What?
She barked. Clearly, Brother Oliver had been right. She needed divine assistance. Evangeline shook her head. I'm sorry, she said as gently as she could to the young novice standing at the door, her pale face peeking through the opening. Sister Margaret, please, come in. Come in. She sat up from the kneeling bench to the pew and waved the young woman inside.
She rested her elbows on her knees.
Sister Divine?
It's Divine. It's pronounced Divine, not Divine. And just call me Sister Eve or Sister Evangeline. You don't call us by our last names.
I'm so sorry. I'm sorry.
The novice had been at the monastery only a couple of weeks and was still learning the names of the sisters and the proper ways to address them. She was thin and nervous, and she stood just inside the chapel entrance, her voice so low Evangeline could hardly hear.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.